Thank you. jazz music is America's one of their only true art forms. Usually at this time in a concert, I go through a whole historical thing, which if anyone has ever been to this concert before, you probably don't need to hear right now. So I'm going to skip ahead and just tell you it in kind of shorthand. Jazz music is the result of West African music and Western European music blending, commingling, because of slavery. And West African music has its own characteristics, Western European has its own characteristics, and they blended together through 250 years of slavery in this country, and jazz music, this music that you're hearing here, is kind of the result there. That's the end of that kind of history lesson. Jazz music started in full bloom in this country around 1920. And then it evolved every 10 years, every decade, jazz changed. It was very primitive and simple. Untrained musicians were playing by ear in the 20s in New Orleans. In the 30s, a whole new kind of jazz music happened that involved bigger bands, dance band music, ballroom dancing. It became very popular. It was the most popular music of the day, big band jazz music. In the 40s, next decade became very experimental as jazz became kind of a self-conscious art form. And the 50s was a different kind of jazz. In the 60s, jazz started to be affected by rock and roll, which was the new American popular music. But jazz has been part of the American musical scene right up to this day, 100 years later, from 1920 to 2020. So what we're going to do today is kind of play, we're going to hopscotch back and forth between decades. We're going to start around the 20s and the 30s and the 40s. I'm sorry, we will not be playing any rock and roll per se today. But I will just tell you a little bit about each tune and which decade it would have been heard in, and so you can get a sense of, a historical sense of what jazz music has been through the 20th century, when it was America's very serious popular and art music. This next tune is an example of mini big band music that was found in the 1950s. So this is a tune called Maiden Voyage, and it will feature three of our soloists. Oh, I left out the most important part. Jazz music is an improvisational music. So what you just heard us do there, we played a song, an arrangement, we played pretty music, and then suddenly the baritones played a solo, improvised. Our pianist played a solo, totally making it up. And Jesse, our guitarist, was also improvising. Throughout this whole concert, you will hear people improvising, not just reading notes, but making up their own stuff. So here is a tune called Maiden Voyage.
Thank you.
Levi. Serious rock and roll, counterculture, late 60s, revolutionary type music, rock and roll at the time. But there was also a new kind of jazz music, improvisational music, that had worked its way into the fabric of American music from Brazil. And it was called the bossa nova. It was a Latin beat, and every so often you'll hear the term Latin beat, and really what that means is that the rhythms came from Latin America, so very often that kind of gets lost in the shuffle. You say, well, this is a Latin tune, but what that really means is that the rhythm, the beat, the percussion is playing music that was found in Brazil, Argentina, and the Latin American countries. And the bossa nova, brand new kind of Latin beat from Brazil, was turned jazz around a little bit, it innovated it in the 60s with all the rock and roll. So we're going to do a classic standard tune called Polka Dots and Moonbeams, featuring our trombone section, and featuring our guest pianist. If any of you is wondering why someone so old looks like he's in his band. It's okay, he says the same thing about me. That is our visiting guest. He's a wonderful pianist, very world-renowned. He's the pianist with the Boston Pops. He's recorded and played with John Williams, the great composer. And his name is Ben Cook. Why don't we have a hand for him? So this will feature our trombone section and Ben Cook on Polka Dots and Moonbeams.
Thank you.
Jazz music historically has been instrumental music. All the great jazz innovators throughout jazz history happen to be horn players or piano players, saxophones or trumpets. But it also has a great tradition of vocal music as well. There are lots of world famous singers who are noted for their jazz stylings, and people like, these are names that probably most of you will not know, but they are legendary in their own worlds. Ella Fitzgerald and Louis Armstrong, great jazz trumpet player, but also a great vocalist. And so we are going to feature one of our vocalists right now, the vocalist, and she's a wonderful jazz singer in her own right. Miss Rhiannon Hurst is going to come up and sing a classic.
Classic that you're about to sing.
Straighten Up and Fly Right is a song that has transcended these.
I mentioned the decade thing, 40s, 50s, 60s, something represented something else. But this tune was a hit in the 1940s and the 1950s, different performers, and the 1960s, and it's performed to this day by jazz singers, and it is called Straighten Up and Fly Right.
Said, now listen, Jack, straighten up and fly right. sounds just like a lie. Breaking up with my ride.
Songwriters would write songs that everybody performed. And so they were called standards because they were repertoire that people from Frank Sinatra to Barbara Streisand, whoever was a singer, would choose their favorite songs from songs that had been written for everyone to sing. Hence the word standards. And Rhiannon is going to do a standard right now, a classic by Richard Rodgers, who's a very famous composer of songs and Broadway shows and so forth. And it is called My Funny Valentine, and it's just going to feature Ben and Rhiannon.
Thank you. Yes, we're going to be doing My Funny Valentine. Ben had improvised on the first tune, and as did I, so we're going to be seeing a little bit more of that in this tune. Hope you enjoy. Thank you.
mentioned that the early 20s, so the 1920s, the bands were smaller, and most of the horn section were usually one instrument per family. So an early jazz band in the 1920s would have one trumpet, one clarinet, one trombone. And in the 30s, the bands got bigger. They started to add the saxophone, and then started to add two saxophones and three. And suddenly the bands had five saxophones and eight brass. They were really, they were called big bands, and because they were big, and they were babies. And so the big band era was considered from 1930 to 1940. And in the 1940s to 1950, the musicians got experimental. They realized that what they were doing as improvisers might be more than just entertaining the public or providing dance music. They might be making art. And so they started to use odd instruments, instruments that were not usually the same as solo instruments, like the trumpet, the clarinet, and the trombone. So one of these odd instruments that started to work its way into the instrumentation of jazz music, especially in the 1950s, was this instrument right here. This kind of saxophones, as you probably know, saxophones are a family of instruments that start from very small instruments to very large ones like that, but they're all played the same way. So that you can play that, you can play the smaller one, like Tasha's playing the alto, or a little tiny one like the soprano. But this instrument started to be featured as a jazz solo instrument in the 50s. And the tune that we're about to do now is called Bernie's Tune, and it was written in 1950, and it became a classic jazz tune of the 50s featuring the baritone sax.
One, two, three.
history, and almost all of them, of course, have long since passed away. The most famous and the first famous jazz musician was Louis Armstrong, and he was a product of the 1920s. He was a superstar right up until the 1960s, playing folk-style music and singing. And there are others, names that you might know here just in passing through history, saxophone player named John Coltrane, saxophone player named Charlie Parker, Duke Ellington, Miles Davis. These are all iconic names in jazz history, and they are all long since passed away. There's still one jazz giant that is alive, and I don't know how well you could be in your 90s, but he is in his 90s, and his name was Sonny Rollins, and he was a major saxophonist in the 40s and 50s, a major jazz saxophonist. And he wrote an iconic jazz standard that somehow has worked its way into people's DNA. People who have never heard this song somehow know the name of this song. And if we ever do concerts where we take requests, I guarantee you somebody would say, do you do St. Thomas? St. Thomas is the name of a Sonny Rollins tune, and it is, like I say, it's in people's DNA. People who have never heard it, never heard of Sonny Rollins, but somehow they know the name of St. Thomas. So we're going to do St. Thomas, and we are going to feature our guest pianist, Ben Cook.
Thank you.
Ben Cook on the piano, and Cole on the drum. Jazz music was, at its very inception, a folk music, a folk instrumental music. The original players in the 1920s from New Orleans did not read music. They played by ear. They learned to play by listening and watching other people. They didn't read notes. They didn't have lessons. And that this whole new improvisational music came out of a self-taught discipline. That had to change in the 1930s when the bands got bigger because people had to learn how to read music. It's one thing to have three guys faking it, but it's a totally different thing to have 15 guys faking it. Someone's going to run into somebody else, so you had to learn to read. And by the 1930s, there were some very well-trained and schooled musicians that were famous for playing jazz music. And one of the most famous was a clarinetist named Benny Goodman. He was from Chicago, and he had a very famous jazz band in the 1930s and 40s and 50s. He was a clarinet player, but unlike many of the other jazz players of the time, he was a classically trained clarinetist. Not only did he improvise, but he could also play the music of Mozart. Brilliant classical clarinetist, as well as a very unbelievable jazz clarinet player. In fact, jazz music was always held in disrepute by the, let's say, the upper class. It was a barroom music, which it was, and it was a music that was for dancing and entertainment for the lower, so-called lower classes. As a result, it was never allowed to be performed in any of the upper class performing areas, like, for example, Carnegie Hall, until 1938. And in 1938 was a very revolutionary time in jazz history. It was the first time that a jazz band had ever performed at Carnegie Hall. And that band was led by Benny Goodman. And one of the reasons that he managed to slip his band into this very prestigious concert hall was because he was known as a classically trained clarinetist. In fact, he was so renowned that people like Stravinsky and Bela Bartok, these are all huge names, and Aaron Copland, these are huge names in 20th century classical music, all wrote pieces for Benny Goodman specifically, because he was capable of playing it. Now, having said all that, you can't imagine the pressure I have just put on this next person. Kathleen is our clarinetist right here in the middle of everything, and she is going to play two tunes by herself with Ben and Jesse on guitar that were featured and made famous by the great Benny Goodman. The first is a ballad, it's a slow tune, his theme song, and she and Ben and Jesse will play that. And then she's going to play a very technical piece called Tattletale, which Benny Goodman wrote and performed, that requires all the skill and technique of a real classically trained clarinet player. There. She's as cool as a cucumber. Okay.
Thank you.
I should just throw in here that when people do pieces like this in a real recital, like a recital, after she would have played that piece, she would have walked off, caught her breath, relaxed, and then come out prepared to do this. But we're not doing that. So I'm stalling for time while she just kind of catches her breath. And then I'm going to say, and how about one more hand for Kathleen while she plays? One, two, two, two. we'll see you soon. Thank you very much.